How's everybody today?
Good morning.
Wow, good. Boy, we are filling up down here. This is great. You know, pretty soon, the only seats that will be available are right behind me. right under the cross. Remember the old invitation hymn? There's room at the cross for you. Remember, you just have to know and love the Lord and sing on pitch. I don't care what part you sing, or if you've ever sung in a choir before, join us. We just love praising the Lord together. Well, welcome everybody here. If you're a visitor, you'll notice in the bulletin there is a tear-off sheet that says, welcome. Tear that off. We'd like to know who you are. If you want to fill that out and just drop that in the offering plate. Just a few announcements. Let's see what's coming up this week. Joyful Mixers, you have a trip on Friday, September 9th. I noticed already on the sign-up sheet in the hallway, people are signing up. So take a look at that. And if you are interested, please put your name down. Magic, there's going to be a meeting Saturday morning, 8:30 for breakfast, 9:30 for training, 10 a.m. for distribution. Now, this is what the people involved in Magic hand out to newcomers in our area. This is filled with really neat stuff that people can use. I mean, it's not just, you know, junky stuff that you're going to look at and say, and toss it. No, there's really nice things. As a matter of fact, I'm going to keep this bag myself. By a show of hands, how many people here have gotten one of these? Look at this. That's great. Wow. That's a lot. All right. We want to increase that number. So please, if you're interested in being part of Magic, Saturday, 8:30, have a good breakfast, half-hour training section, and that would be wonderful.
That's on September 10th.
Yes.
Saturday, September 10th.
You know, I really should read these. Okay. New members class. Maybe. I looked at the sheet to sign up. The sheet is full. But Pastor is trying to make some arrangements, so we'll hold on for that. But that starts Sunday, September 18th. Okay. And let me remind you, this is not a class where you have to join the church. It's a class where you find out what we believe and what our church is like, and then you make the decision whether you'd like to join or not, okay? Finally, we have the Baptist Men's Fellowship Kickoff Potluck Supper, Thursday. I tell you what, you got bulletins, look at it. All right, September 29th. I'm glad I don't do this for a living. Anyway, we're starting with a medley called the Great God Medley. We have a great and wonderful God, Savior and the Lord, and we're going to sing about that now. Diane will be singing in the to start. And then we will join in on the chorus of this song. I did that because I'm not sure you all know it, okay? It's a beautiful worship song, and then we'll all continue on from there. So let's stand and praise the Lord.
Shadows in the light.
quiet in our hearts and our minds, and we want you to know that we're thankful that you love us. Father, we're thankful that you proved that by giving Christ for us. You in your word says, scarcely for a righteous man would someone die, but Christ died for sinners. You've redeemed us and called us your own and have adopted us into your family. And Father, we as your children say hallelujah to your name. We were so lost and so undone. Our feet were in the miry clay. We were stuck. But you rescued us, snatched us out, and you have placed our feet on a solid rock, and his name is the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And we, as your children, have gathered to celebrate your goodness and his great sacrifice. He is our Lord. He is our returning King. Jesus, you are wonderful and exalted in this place. We love you. We appreciate you, Lord. We honor you as the audience of one in this place. Lord, we sing for your glory. We sing to make you famous. We sing because we are needy and you are awesome and meet every need in this place. And God, we lift our hearts and our minds and our hands to you and we say, Abba, Father. You're such a wonderful daddy. And God, I'm thankful that there's not a need in this place that you don't see. There's not a hurt. There's not a situation that you don't have the power to heal and fix. And God, we come with our hearts open, and Lord, we come with humility. Lord, we don't demand anything of you. We just give you our worship today. And we know that in that atmosphere, you'll be gracious and merciful. And Lord, if our hearts are humble and receptive, not one of us this day will leave without our needs having been met. Thank you for this congregation of people, Lord, who love you. Thank you that we've gathered in this place. And Lord, we give you glory and ask you to take this hour, anoint it with your Spirit. Holy Spirit, have your way. And point us to Christ. And we, your children, will give you glory. And Father, we pray in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
You can be seated for just one moment. I just want to say thank you so much for coming today, and I just want to brag on how well you all sing. I just love how this congregation sings, and it just encourages me, and I appreciate that so much. If you're a guest with us today, we are the perfect place for imperfect people. If you haven't got it together, you will fit in here well. And we welcome you today and just hope that you sense that God loves you and that the people in this room love you as well. We're going to have a children's moment this time. Miss Stacy's going to come, and our kids are coming. Oh, y'all look so cute. Hey, girl. How are you?
Well, we have a curriculum that we just, and I've told y'all about it last month because we introduced y'all to Savannah. Well, right? We had Savannah last month. Who do we have this month?
Ray.
That's right. Her name is Ray. And I'm going to show you a little snippet of what we do. We have times we move around. And this is how we introduce our lesson to them every week. And they have a character. So, and then I have something very special for them after this is over. So, what do we do first? How do we get over there? We buzz. So, Mr. Mike, cue up Buzzley the Bee.
Yeah.
Jack!
we live in the water. So we head down to a deep sea bathtub. There, special fish take any bugs or germs off of us. Huh, that's much better. Being a manta ray isn't always smooth sailing, but I've learned to go with the flow. Ever wish you were a manta ray? Just gliding through the day? You've probably got some stuff in your life that feels really hard. Maybe you don't have a friend to play with, or you have to wait for something you really want. These are struggles, things that are really hard, and you just can't make them go away. But guess what? You're not alone. You can trust God to help you.
Trust
in the Bible, Psalms chapter 33, verse 4, it says, "For the word of the Lord holds true, and we can trust everything he does." In the Bible, a man named Jacob had to face his brother Esau. He expected Esau to be really mad at him, but God surprised Jacob. Esau forgave Jacob and gave him a hug. Can you give someone a hug right now? Find a friend, give them a little smile. Trust God. Let's tell Buzzley B the great news. We'll say we can trust God together on the count of three. 1, 2, 3.
Thank you.
broken heart close against his shoulders as he wept. Love beyond the moment scarred the hands and feet of one I've never met. The world saw a man die a martyr. But God saw a lamb bridge a gap of eternity.
Thank you.
love and the spirit here, but we don't have a lot of organization.
Oh,
Miss Marion said that was the Pentecostal coming in. It's good to worship the Lord together. Amen. God is good. I have the privilege of introducing someone to you today that I love dearly. He is my first cousin, Mike Griggs. My dad was the oldest son in the Gullidge family. His mom was the oldest daughter. He's a wonderful Christian guy. It's 11:35, and I pray you'll be patient. I told him to preach as long as he wants to, but I'm going to let you know just a little bit about him that he wants to share with you. He had colon cancer. His liver was shutting down. He was septic. They had tubes trying to drain the gangrene out of his body. He was in the hospital for almost 6 weeks, and they gave him up for dead. And a little nurse walked in the middle of the night one night. Mike is a bivocational pastor. He worked at the hospital, and I think this nurse knew you. And she said, "Mike, I've come to pray for you." And with nobody there, she just laid a hand on Mike's shoulder. Were you there in the room? Yeah. Brenda was there, his wife, and all of them. And she prayed a sweet little prayer. And guess what God did through that prayer? He walked out alive from that hospital. Had all kind of surgeries. A lot of us question if God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. You can't convince Mike Griggs he's not the same yesterday, today, and forever. Because when the world gave up on him and told him he was going to die, and doctors just didn't know what to do, a humble little lady walked into a room and laid a hand on his shoulder and prayed for him, and he's alive today. Mike had a terrible case of COVID. He was in ICU. He was in the hospital for 19 days, and it did not look good. They were trying to keep him off of the ventilator. And I called him one day, and this is what he said. He said, "I'm just looking for somebody who will agree with me." That God will let me live. There are a lot of people who just won't pray for me. And I told him over the phone, and I said, "Mike, I agree with you, brother." I said, "God, he's going to heal you. He's going to get you out of there." And I prayed with him over the phone, and I'm nobody. But I got a phone. I looked at my wife. I said, "Mike Griggs is going to walk out of the hospital." I said, "I have no doubt God's going to raise him up." And guess what God did? God raised him up, and you're going to get to hear him preach today. Now, he's full of the Holy Ghost, as he said. So, he's a Baptist pastor at Bethel Baptist Church in Newton, Alabama. He and his wife are godly, godly people. Very humble folks. And I love them dearly. And Brenda's such a wonderful pastor's wife. And I just want to introduce you to my cousin, my friend, my brother in Christ. Mike, come preach for us.
Well, praise the Lord.
Tell you what. Ooh, that's hot. Yeah, I had the colon and liver cancer, by the way. It was metastasized to my liver, and they gave me 9 months to live. And so, can you say, "But God"? Can I brag for just a moment on worship? Man, it was over the top. Wow. I'm so, wow. All I can say is, wow, the worship was wonderful. I almost took a lap, and I figured you'd run me off, so I stayed in my seat. But I'll tell you, what a blessing. What a blessing. My wife, Brenda, she has put up with me for 43 years. I don't know why she did, but I'm so grateful, amen, that she did. She has a wonderful, wonderful help me to me, and she has been. We have 2 boys, 6 grandchildren, 2 great-grandchildren, and we have, the 2 greats are not saved yet, but we're praying as quick as they can understand it, Amen. They'll be saved and we'll all be in heaven one day. As we get carried away, as the song said. Amen. But thank you so much. You've been so gracious. And thank you for letting me come today and share with you. Now let me tell you just a little bit about your pastor.
Bring it on.
You were very fortunate to have Brother Chris and Miss Stacy here. Some of the most loving. I hope you know you just didn't hire a preacher. You hired a pastor. A shepherd. And he will love you. And they will love you. Ethan will even love you. Amen. And so you're very fortunate, McCormick, to have Brother Chris here. I've watched him.
We are blessed.
Yes, you are blessed, brother, for sure. Chris has actually been in the ministry longer than I have. And I've watched him over the years. And he's steadfast. He comes from good stock. I understood you heard Brother Winford preach recently.
Yes. Yes.
It's a good thing you didn't hear him when he was 60. He is a wonderful man. I love my uncle. Amen. So, Brother Chris comes from good stock. Well, let me go ahead and preach for you. You've got those signs for the minutes. I don't want to run over. Brother Chris said he usually preaches about an hour and a half, so he said I had an hour and a half. Amen. If you have your Bible and you like to follow along, would you be turning to Matthew's Gospel? Matthew's Gospel, chapter number 7. Matthew's Gospel, chapter number 7. Now, at our church, we stand at the reading of God's Word, and if you don't want to do that, that's great. But if you feel liberty to do that, you do that. We're just going to read two verses. Matthew's Gospel, chapter number 7, verses 13 and 14. This is the Master speaking, by the way. If your Bible has Jesus' Word written in red, it's Jesus is speaking. Look what He said. Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go therein or out. Because straight is the gate, narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be of that find it. Pray with me, would you please? Father in heaven, what an honor to be here today. What an honor to sense the sweet Holy Ghost of God. Father, would you help me this morning as I'm a frail earthen vessel? But would you send the unction of the Holy One that I might speak something to be an encouragement? Father, to be enlightened. And give us ears to hear this morning, Father. And thank you, Lord, for another opportunity to share the good news that Jesus saves. And Father, we'll be quick to give Jesus the honor, Him the praise, for He is worthy. And all God's people said,
Amen.
You may be seated. Thank you so much for standing and honoring God's Word. How many of you know Jesus said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall never, amen, pass away. Well, quickly this morning, I want to share with you two gates, two ways, two groups, two destinations if you're taking notes this morning. You see, every one of us that's here today is on a spiritual journey. You say, well, wait a minute, preacher, I don't really believe that. Well, you're true. You are on a spiritual journey, whether you have received Christ as Savior and King, but you're still traveling a spiritual journey. Whether you say, well, I'm not religious, I'm not, but you're on a spiritual path. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Every day we make choices that affect the direction in which we are headed. Many people think that the paths they travel, and there is many paths that we can travel. Jesus said there was just two paths, two ways. And each one of us this morning are headed on a path and on a way. I'm reminded of Albert Einstein. He was a pretty bright fellow, could you say, man? He was on a train when he was older in age, and Lord, I'm getting there, and I'm very forgetful, amen. My wife is my best memory that I have. She'll say, you know, you got to go to so-and-so and this and that. But Albert was traveling on a train when he was on up in age, and they came by, the conductor came by to check his ticket, and he had lost it. He could not find it. The conductor said, oh, Mr. Einstein, it's okay. I know who you are, and I know where you're headed. And so he went on by and he came back, and Mr. Albert Einstein was on his hands and knees and he was looking for his ticket. And the conductor said, you don't have to do that. I know, Mr. Einstein, I know who you are and I know where you're headed. And he looked up at him with on his knees on the floor. He said, I know who I am, but I really don't remember where I'm headed. So this morning, I figure you know who you are. But with God's help, you'll know where you're headed when you leave today. Two gates, Jesus said. Jesus said there was a wide gate. A wide gate in chapter 7, verse 13. You see, this gate represents a way. Jesus went on to say that it represented destruction. It's described as a wide gate, evidently a gate which allows many to go through. I call it the self gate. Amen. We can walk through that wide gate. It does not require us to give up a whole lot. One is allowed to take whatever baggage they desire on that road through the wide gate. Amen. Believe whatever one wants to believe. Can I tell you, precious people, this morning, a lot of people today, and even in the pulpits of America, would like you to believe there's many ways to get to heaven. But I want you to know this morning, there's only one way. And His name is Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And so we need to realize something. You see, what you believe will affect your behavior. You need to write that down. Say amen. What you believe will affect the way you live your life. You know, I deer hunt just a little bit of the day. Praise the Lord. And when I started deer hunting, an older gentleman was teaching me, and he said, if you'll take a strand of that barbed wire, you'll raise it up and tie it. He said, those deer will come through and they'll cross right there because it's least resistant. They'll come and he said, you could kill you a good buck because that's where they'll cross. Can I tell you, a lot of people today are taking the path or the gate of least resistance. No restrictions, no concerns. But then thank God Jesus said there was another gate. Jesus said there was a narrow gate. Amen. The gate that represents the beginning, a starting point, if you will. And Jesus said that that gate led to life. Why is the gate so narrow? Because it's a gate. Sometimes that's hard to pass through. Jesus Himself said, I did not come upon this earth to bring peace, but a sword. What did Jesus mean by that? He said, listen, if you really sell out to me, if you really surrender to me, it's going to bring a sword with you and some people. Can you say amen? Amen. Some people are not going to want to sell out to me. You know, the guy I trust least in this life that I live, the guy that I used to shave with when I looked in the mirror. Can somebody say amen? Because you see, mankind left unto himself will destroy it. So without the Holy Spirit of God living on the inside, I can't be trusted. And neither can you. God allows us to have the sweet Holy Spirit to help us live the life that He wants us to live. You know, Jesus said something very interesting. Matthew chapter 6, verse 19 and verse 20. Jesus said, lay not up for yourself treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do corrupt, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourself, Jesus said, treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust do corrupt, and where thieves do not break through or steal. And he went on to say that where your treasure is, there your heart will be also.
That's right.
So what's your treasure this morning? You know, the Apostle Paul said we have this treasure in earthen vessel. He's talking about the treasure of the Holy Spirit in this earthen vessel that we live. And so listen to me. This morning, there's two gates. There's a wide gate, there's a narrow gate, and that's a starting point. But Jesus went on to say that there are two ways. Amen. Jesus said the broad way. He said the broad way leads to destruction. Any behavior, amen, is all right. I am very impatient the older I get, and I ask God to help me work on that. My wife reminds me of that quite often. If I ever go through a drive-thru to get a hamburger, nobody will have to pull up and wait but me. Brother Dave, I get so aggravated, and I tell my wife they saw me coming. But you know what? I've tried to be a little more understanding with the employment like it is today. But you know what? Even though I have to wait, I'm grateful when I get that Big Mac. Two ways, a broad way, destruction. Did you know there's a constricted way too? As a matter of fact, the New King James calls it a difficult way. The King James calls it a narrow way. It's a picture, if you will, of a narrow path between two cliffs. And you say, well, the gospel must be very difficult. No, we had revival last week, and we had a 5 or 6 year old little boy, honey. He's 5 years old. He came down to the altar. And said he needed to be saved. 5 now. His daddy began to quit. Because you understand at 5 years old, you want to know that this young child understands what's going on. And his daddy said, he's got better theology about being saved than I do. Amen. The gospel is a very simple message. Can you say amen?
Amen.
The way that leads to life, Jesus said. One day Jesus was on the streets, his disciples were there, and they were looking at the Pharisees, and Jesus made a statement. He said, least your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees. Jesus said this. He said, ye shall nowise enter into heaven. He said, you won't make it. I wonder if the disciples said, well, Lord, then who's going to make it? But you see, they were just religious. A narrow way. Jesus described two gates, two ways. But listen, he also reminds us of this. There's two groups. If you're in the congregation today, you're part of one of these two groups. You say, no, no, yes you are. Not a prophet, don't claim to be. But the Bible's pretty clear that you're in one of these groups. Well, preacher, what group? Well, Jesus said that wide is the gate. And Jesus went on to say that many there go by it. So many go in the wide gate. As a matter of fact, if you do the math, Jesus taught really a 50% about getting saved. More people won't be saved than will be saved. If you look at the teachings of Jesus, we've seen reasons for this. The broad way makes my own rules. Amen. The Broadway, the group of many, they believe what they want. But then there's also another group, the few. I pray this morning that you're part of the few and not part of the many. Part of the few. You say, well, preacher, I just can't go with that. Well, let's go back to the Old Testament. Now, we live in the New Testament times. We realize we're a New Testament church. When they closed that ark, I believe millions drowned. Could you agree with me one time?
Yes.
How many were saved?
Eight.
That's a few. Say amen. What about when they were wandering in the wilderness? Moses had a bunch of Baptists he was leading. Can you say amen? I'm a Baptist. I can talk about us. Amen. They were murmuring, man, listen. You ought to have left us in Egypt. At least we had something to eat. A whole generation. Two out of the generation made it into the promise. Amen. Can you say amen? The few. On another occasion, Luke chapter 13, verse 23 and 24, then said one of them to him, Lord, are there few that'll be saved? And he said unto them, strive, listen to what Jesus said, strive to enter in at the straight gate. For many, I say unto you, will seek to enter in and shall not be able. Wow. That must be found. Strive, Jesus said, strive to enter in through the narrow gate. So there's two groups of people. But you know what else? And sometimes when I preach at home, I get a little long-winded. And the greatest thing they want me to say is, and in closing. But I've conditioned them pretty good, you know. I tell them, I said, listen, I wasn't raised in church. I got saved really late in life. And thank God for God's, amen, long suffering. If I'd have been me, I'd have wiped me out a long time ago. So I tell them when I act up in church, I don't know no better because I was not raised in church. There's two destinations. Finally, we see Jesus say there's two destinations. Destruction. That's on the Broadway. Paul wrote this. Listen to what Paul said in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7 and 9. He's talking about those who rejected the gospel. Listen to what he said. In flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God, and that obey not the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord, from the glory of His power. You say, preacher, that's pretty negative. It is. It is. Let me tell you what, a preacher that loves you will tell you the whole truth.
Yes.
You got one that will. I would heap rather a man hurt my feelings and me go to heaven than pat me on the back and go to destruction. How about you?
Amen.
Paul did not lie to us. I believe if anybody was plugged into the gospel, it was the Apostle Paul.
Yes, sir.
And so there's also life. Matthew 25, 46, Jesus said this, and these shall go away into everlasting punishment, but I got good news this morning.
Amen.
The righteous into eternal life. Hey, you know, the older I get, the sweeter heaven sounds. I'm 62. And when y'all started singing that song about being carried away, I thought to myself, there's coming a day when we all be carried away.
If
Jesus tarried. I did a funeral recently of a 41-year-old young man that played baseball, football for me for years. And I'll tell you what, he's got four kids. But thank God he can wait on those four kids to get to heaven to be joined with them again. And I thought to myself, you know, That's young. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And I look around the congregation, I look at myself and how blessed I've been to live this long on this earth and to be able to be a witness for Christ.
Yes.
But that's what we should all be doing, being a witness for Christ.
Amen.
Two gates, two ways, two groups, two destinations. Are there many roads to heaven? There's one. Many people like to think there's more. Many like to say all religions, if you will, lead to heaven. It really doesn't matter what you believe. You can do whatever you feel like and you'll still get to heaven. But that's not true, because if you leave Christ out of the equation, my dear friend, you won't make it.
That's right.
Neither will I.
That's right.
Now, according to Jesus, there's two roads, two ways. One leads to life and heaven. The other leads to destruction. Jesus Himself, in John chapter 14, verse 6, said, "I am the way." Didn't say I was many ways. He said, "I am the way." What else?
The truth.
And?
The life.
No man
comes to the Father but by me.
Hallelujah. That's exactly right. So now, if they were many ways, Jesus would have said, "I am one of the ways." But He didn't say that. Jesus said, "I am the way. I am the truth. And I am the life." Any baseball fans in the place? Let me see your hand. We're not taking up another offering. Let me see your hand. How many has ever heard of Babe Ruth? Man, everybody, yeah. When Babe Ruth was at his pinnacle, many said he had the strongest bat that ever swung. Later in life, he got traded to the Braves, away from the Yankees. I believe it was with the Yankees. And he was not very good. He had put on a show for many years, Brother Chris. Hit a lot of home runs. 714. Tell old Hammer and Hank, you know, broke his record. He got traded to the Cincinnati Braves, I believe it was. Was trying to still play. He was over, can you say over the hill? But he was still trying to play. That particular game, he struck out three or four times, made many errors, cost the Braves a lot of runs. And aren't people fickle?
Yes. Yes.
The crowd began to boo. They began to boo the Babe. And all of a sudden, this little boy jumped over the rail, tears in his eyes, and he ran out to Babe Ruth and just jumped on his leg and started hugging. Babe Ruth, they said, scooped him up in his arms, walked over into the dugout, walked off the field together. He said, "Why do you tell that story, preacher?" "Well, I want to tell you this. I'm a little bit like Babe Ruth. I wasn't a great baseball player. I had nothing much to offer the Lord Jesus. Man, I was used up, wasted, on the road to destruction. Then a man named Jesus leaped over the railing of glory. And He came into this world, lived a perfect life, shed His blood on Calvary, rose from the dead. And when I figured out He did it for me,
that's right.
Hallelujah. He took me by His hand, my hand. And at 36 years old, saved me. Wrote my name in glory."
Yes,
sir. Now, We're walking across the field of life. Headed to the dugout. You know what I found out? I found out he was not ashamed of me. I found out he wasn't mad with me. I found out he loved me more than anybody else. Ever. And we always love to read John 3:16. Amen. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And we leave out 17.
Yes, sir.
That says, for God sent not his Son into this world to condemn you, that through his Son the world might be saved.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
My friends, when I found that out, it made a difference. Can you say, oh, what a Savior? Let me ask a question this morning. Do you know him? You say, well, preacher, sure I know him. Do you know him, or do you just know about him? Maybe you're here, and all those years God spared my life, he knew I'd be in McCormick, South Carolina today. I didn't know that. To tell you how much Jesus loves you, cares about you, and he wants to spend eternity with you. And if you know him as your personal Savior, one day that'll happen. But I wonder if you're here today and you say, preacher, I just never have made that profession of faith in Jesus. But today, the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart. And I'll have to do that today. Your dear pastor would be elated to lead you to Christ today. Do you know him today? What gate are you traveling? What way are you going? Are you one of the few? Are you one of the many? There's a difference. And that difference is Jesus of Nazareth. Would you pray with me, Father? Father, thank you so much for loving us. Father, I pray today that you'd speak to the hearts of these precious people. Lord, I pray today that you would allow them to see how much you love them. Father, I pray today that you would allow them to see and to sense the precious Holy Spirit of God. Speak to hearts, Father. Woo them, Father, into a loving relationship with a loving Lord. Father, help them to make that profession of faith. Help them, Lord, to reach a place where they say, I surrender. Father, if there's one in this building, by the way of my voice, that's never received Christ, I pray today, Father, that would be it. Today would be the day. There's a Christian here, and I believe there's many. And Father, they need a closer walk. Father, take them by the hand. Lead them. Pull them to your breast. Let them know just how much you love them. Father, have your will and way. Time of benediction, Father. We'll praise you for it. We ask it in Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people say it.
Amen.
Will you stand, Brother Chris?
Thank you.
Mike, I appreciate that. And I just want to say this. Christ's invitation to His grace doesn't end when we leave this church. If God has spoken to your heart, you can get on your knees or bow and sit in a chair in your own home and say, Lord, I cannot get away from what Pastor Mike said today. And I want to be on the right path, and I want to know you as my Savior. And you know what? He will welcome you wherever you are. And I know this, someone who truly yields their heart to Him and asks Christ to save them, they can't keep it a secret. They got to tell somebody. Mike, you bless my heart. And if you're a guest with us today, thank you so much for being here. Mike and Brenda will be at the door, and I know you'll want to come see them. New members class, we're going to kick off here in a few weeks. If you're interested in being part of that, we have plenty of room. It's just a chance to find out who we are as a church, to find out a little bit about what we believe, where we believe we're headed, and what we believe God is doing in our church. And it's also a chance for you to ask any questions you want. And we would welcome you to come if you feel the Lord leading you. We need to recognize our chairman of our nominating committee, Chairman Deacons, for just a moment. Our nominating committee report for the 2022-2023 church year for officers is out in the foyer. Make sure you get one. But there are a couple things that Brother George Patterson needs to come and share with us at this time.
As Pastor Chris said, we finally finished the nominating committee report, so be sure to pick up a copy because we were voting 2 weeks on this. We had two exceptions we're asking for this year on the nominating committee report. We're asking, you know, normally a member goes off, you serve you 3 years, you go off, you stay off a year, but we have special circumstances. We're asking that you allow us to leave Glenn Wright on Property and Grounds Committee because he's got a lot of things going on and right in the middle of them. And we think for the sake of continuity, that's the best thing to do. We also would like to keep Larry Baker on the Personnel Committee for another year because Pastor Chris hasn't been here a year yet. It's good to have somebody there that he's dealt with and has been dealing with. We ask for those two exceptions. Next Sunday after next, we will vote on the nominating committee report. And if any of you just eager to serve on any of these committees, I'm sure we've got somebody to give up a seat. So. Thank you very much.
I appreciate how the nominating committee went about that. And I also appreciate those that were asked to serve, being willing to serve instantaneously. God is working in our midst. The Joyful Mixers are starting again. We're going to see a new movie, and we thought we had the ability to show the video, but our video process has gone down. Brother Mike said, he looked at me and went, and so I don't know what the deal is, but it's a movie. You remember the guys who put out Fireproof and Courageous? Those are the guys that are doing this movie. It's called Life Point, and it's about adoption. So if you want to sign up for the Joyful Mixers, Miss Myra Phillips and King David, are heading up that group. And we're going to be going, I think, on September 9th. There'll be more information, like it's in the announcements. But, man, we love you guys. Stand with me, and let's close in prayer. Before we leave, I know we've gone over just a little, but we are the body of Christ. And if you have something on your heart and you want us to pray with you about it, would you raise your hand? Something on your heart? In Alabama, they call those unspoken requests, just something that I'd rather not share publicly, but I need God to intervene in my life. Father, we thank you for the truth of your word. We thank you for the spirit that it was presented in. God, I thank you for Mike and Brenda, how you're using them in Alabama. I thank you that he's alive, Lord, by your grace. Lord, you healed him when doctors thought that there was no hope. And Lord, for the people in this room, I'm so thankful for them, Father. What you're doing in this congregation, the love that you have exhibited to us, and Lord, how we are learning to love each other and you. That's really what church is. We're the perfect place for imperfect people, and God, we are learning to love you and love each other. That's what this church is about. It's a place where you can come, you don't have to put on airs, you don't have to be anything special. Because collectively as a family, we're learning to love you, Father, and love each other. That's our goal, to be disciples who love you supremely and love each other sacrificially. Lord, would you use us in McCormick and in this county and in this state and in this world? Would you do through us what you said you wanted to do, and that's reach the world? So God, as we leave loving you and thankful that you love us. God, help us. Shine on us. Give us your grace and mercy. And cause us to be witnesses to the people and the families that we love. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. God bless you.